There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. Oh, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves when my heart becomes free. And my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the
more. outpouring on it, Lord. Hallelujah, we worship you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord, God, you are welcome in this house. Oh, somebody ought to say that out loud right now. Lord, you are welcome in this place. Come on, somebody ought to welcome him with their praise right now. Come on, church, let's welcome the Lord with our praise. Let's let him know we want him to be in this house. Oh, Jesus, praise God, praise God, praise God. Amen. I want him to feel comfortable in this place. I don't want him to be rejected by my attitude, but I want him to feel welcome. I don't really like going somewhere when somebody doesn't want me to be there and they're kind of pushing me back out. But, you know, you can tell if somebody wants you to be there or not. When my mother and my father came down for the last week, I hope they understood they were welcome. I hugged them, talked to them, fellowshiped with them, spent time with them. I wasn't quiet, didn't hide back in the back room just waiting for them to leave. But I wanted to have communion with them, and I wanted them to understand they were welcome. It's the same way with God, folks. We ought not to come into this place and just sit there and be quiet, but we ought to let him know, hey, you're welcome here, Lord. Come on in this house. We want you to be here. We want you to be in our presence. Somebody ought to welcome the Lord with their praise tonight. Oh, I believe the louder you can be, the more he understands you want him to be here tonight. Somebody ought to say, Lord, you're welcome in this house. Lord, you're welcome in this place. Amen, amen. I want him to feel comfortable. As our ushers are helping us, we'll receive this evening's offering. Amen. It's good to see everyone in God's house. So grateful to see our faithful saints again tonight, to be in fellowship with you again. But we do want to take a moment and especially welcome our guests. Let them know we are grateful that they are with us here tonight. Bethlehem Church, can we welcome our guests? Let them know we appreciate them being with us tonight. Amen. Thank you for being with us. We are honored that you are here. I want to remind you of our church-wide yard sale that's going to be going on the 20th and 21st. And we need you to be involved. We want you to be involved. Good opportunity to clean out your attics and your garage and the like. Bring some things to sell. You are welcome to bring whatever you want to sell. And we want you to register that. I say whatever you want as long as it's appropriate. Now, this is a church yard sale. Let's back up a little bit. As long as it's appropriate. We want you to bring those items to sell. If you're going to sell something, please register with Sister Voskis. Let her know so she can get you a place reserved. If you would like to donate items, strictly donate items to the church for the church to sell, now this is going to be that you've donated them. You'll get nothing in return other than maybe some streets of gold and walls of jasper. It sounds like a pretty good trade-off. But if you just strictly want to donate some things, we are asking for you to bring things that you would appraise for at least $10. We don't want a bunch of trinkets to sell. We're going to run a church booth. You can bring those and donate those. If you want to bring those, you can bring them, and we'll put them in the new auditorium. But anything less than that, we would ask that you would be here to sell those items. And for setting this up and providing all the advertisement and everything, the church is going to ask for 20% of the profits, and you would get the 80%. And all of that is going to go towards our new building, and we're going to start finishing this new sanctuary, which we're extremely excited about. But please come and be a part of that again. Excellent opportunity for you to do some spring cleaning in the fall so we can do some of those things. Please get the word out. Let people know about it, the 20th and the 21st. Also, Meet the Eagles is coming up this Friday. We're going to start serving fish at about 4:30. We'll try to get the ball game started somewhere around 5:30 or 6. So make sure you come out and be a part of that. There are fish tickets available. I know Drew Wilson's got a bunch because he's asked me for a bunch. So you can get to him and get a ticket, or you can come to me and I'll get you a ticket. But please be a part of that, even if you don't buy a ticket. We want you to buy a ticket because it goes towards our athletic fund and helps us to go places and do things. But even if you don't buy a ticket, we want you to come and support our young folks. Be there for them. Stay until it's over. Clap your hands when they score and enjoy supporting these young people. I want to be there for them. I want them to know I care about them. So plan on being there this Friday night. Fish starts at 4:30, and we'll try to get the ball game started somewhere around 5:30 or 6. So make sure you're a part of that. Amen, amen. We're going to ask this evening. We don't have any prayer requests that have been turned in, but you can represent a need by the uplifting of your hand. Believe God to do a great work. Remember Brother James and Sister Della Rose, certainly. And let's go to the Lord in prayer right now over all these needs tonight. God, I'm so grateful for your many wonderful works and the many wonderful things you've done in our life. God, I believe you. I trust you. I'm committed to you. I'll give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for every miracle, sign, and wonder that I see in my life. God, I want to find a reason to lift up your name. And I pray, God, that you would do a wonderful work. And I promise you, I'll tell this earth of your goodness and your greatness. Have your way in our lives. Do it for your name's sake. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. We're going to ask this evening that if you would to march, bring your offering tonight. Bring it tonight as unto the Lord. Be seated. It's good to have one of our own here tonight doing a great work in the South Haven area. Brother Henderson's with us tonight, and I'm going to ask if he would to stand and testify. I appreciate him being with us tonight. Brother Martinez, I'm going to ask you to stand in just a moment. Brother Henderson. Brother Martinez, if you would, stand and leave a word for
And praise the Lord, everybody. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord tonight. Can you welcome all of our guests to Bethlehem Church? We're so thankful that you're here. Amen. We're certainly excited and thankful that you've come to the house of the Lord tonight. We're thankful for the goodness and the mercy and the grace of God. I do want to make you aware of a couple other things for you to remember next Sunday night. Everybody say Sunday night. Next Sunday night, Brother Mark Stumbo, our missionary to Russia in St. Petersburg, is going to be with us next Sunday night. And on the 22nd, Sunday morning only, Brother Damon McGee from Shreveport, Louisiana, is going to be here. Our next Kineo Resources meeting is November the 30th. That's Monday night at 8 o'clock. And the young people are going to be doing some fundraisers next couple of weeks for National Youth Convention. Amen. As Brother Lovelace said, we're certainly thankful to have all of our guests. We're thankful to have Brother Henderson from down. He's from here, but he's pastoring in the Nesbitt area. Brother Martinez is pastoring in the DeSoto County area over there around Memphis. And both have been members of our church here before. And we're proud of both of them and the work that they're doing for the kingdom of God. And we're thankful for what God is doing through them. Amen. We're excited because we baptized another one in Jesus' name this morning. Praise God. Amen. And I'm glad to be in an apostolic church where we still preach and teach the apostles' doctrine, which is repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. There's still the power of God unto salvation. I'm glad I've been born again, folks. Oh, that's right. Let's stand and praise the Lord together. Can we worship him and thank him for the gospel that was preached and obeyed? Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. As you continue to stand, we are privileged and honored tonight to have with us Sister Karen Harding. We are extremely excited to have her here with us, and we're blessed that we've had the privilege of having her here, and she is a mightily anointed, a woman that works for the kingdom of the Lord, a great singer, and you'll know that in just a few moments. But one of our good friends, Brother Nathan Batson, has her regularly. And he is constantly just bragging about the way the Holy Ghost uses her and moves through her ministry. And I'll tell you a little secret. We have a family in our church, sister, the Butler family, that is a very prominent family in our church, a whole lot of Butlers. Don't ever say anything bad about Stantons, Wilsons, or Butlers, because everybody here except for me and my wife are related to them somehow. But back a few months ago, Sister Harding was in Jackson, Tennessee with Brother and Sister Walker. And after church, while eating, the Lord began to move. And Brother Nicholas, who is married to Judy Peters, Brother Ezra's daughter, that's how I grew up in this church, Brother Nicholas got the Holy Ghost at the table after church on a Sunday night. Amen. That's right, part of us right here. And we're excited to have Sister Harding here. And the Lord began to move, and she began to pray with him, and the Holy Ghost fell. I'm expecting the Holy Ghost to fall here tonight. Put your hands together. Welcome Sister Karen Harding to Bethlehem Church tonight.
Praise the Lord, church. What an honor it is for me to be in the house of the Lord tonight. I'm so thankful that I can stand here in the presence of Almighty God and lift my hands freely and worship Him without fear, without worry that somebody's going to come in and tell me I have to be quiet. Because I love worshiping God. I love being in the presence of the Almighty God. I'm so thankful tonight that He loves me and that He cares about every detail of my life. He loves us. You can sit if you want to. I'm going to read a quick portion of scripture. I always like to start with reading a scripture, and then I'll sing a little bit and testify a little bit, and God's going to do something great in the house tonight. I believe that lives are going to leave different than when they came in. I believe somebody's going to receive the Holy Ghost tonight. I believe somebody is going to be healed tonight, and somebody's going to be encouraged tonight. Hallelujah. In Psalm 27, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat of my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war shall rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple. For in the time of trouble, He shall hide me in His pavilion. In the secret of His tabernacle shall He hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock. And now shall my head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in His tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. And that's what I'm going to do tonight. I'm going to sing praises unto the Lord. I'm going to sing praises to the Most High God who reigns forever and ever. Woo! When I was a little girl, we used to sing this song back in a church that I was raised in. I got the Holy Ghost when I was 5, and we used to sing this song on Sunday night. They used to say something like, anybody got a testimony? Remember those days? And somebody would stand up and say, I believe I'll praise the Lord while I have a chance. And they would sing their testimony. And then somebody else would stand up and say, He's been good to me. God's been good to me. And it wasn't just talking. They were from their heart. They were telling what God had done for them. And one of the songs I remember them singing was this one. And I want to sing it for you tonight. Oh, do you believe He's real? People doubt Him. I can't live In my monitor, hallelujah. My track's just about right. I can't see without my glasses. I was trying to turn my voice up so I won't kill myself on the first song, hallelujah. But isn't he real? Woo! Oh, that's why it doesn't say voice. It says vox. Would you ever figure that out? Hallelujah. Testing 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Yeah, that's good. Stay close. Thank you, sis. Hallelujah. I remember when I was a kid growing up in San Diego. I was about 8 when we moved to San Diego, and there was some crazy things that happened out there. There was an era where we had a bunch of hippies getting saved, guys with long hair and platform shoes coming to the altar, getting filled with the Holy Ghost, and it was pretty awesome. And they'd go down in the water in Jesus' name, and they'd come up different. Their lives were changed. Things happened, and they were a little bit different than they were, a lot different than they were. And we had a crazy, wild worshiping church. We ran and we screamed and we hollered and we jumped and we danced. And yes, sometimes we rolled on the floor and they called us holy rollers. And sometimes we would have collisions. And so finally our pastor put arrows on the wall so we would all run the same direction so nobody would get hurt. And we believed that worship was a verb, an action word. I still believe that when the Holy Ghost hits you, that something happens. Ooh, and somebody, you know, something hits you and you just feel the Holy Ghost. You can't hardly sit still. I was at a church not too long ago. In fact, it was Brother and Sister Green's church in Yukon, Oklahoma. And there was some visitors there. Now, don't worry, visitors. I'm not going to come get you or anything. I'm just a normal person. But I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, and I'm a little different. And I believe that what God's word says is true. But they came Sunday morning, and I talked to them, and they said, you know, you guys are weird. I said, well, that's okay. We've been called a lot of other things, too. And I was, they were on the very back row, right where y'all are sitting back there in the cheap seats. Hallelujah. And so I said, well, you know, you just stick around long enough, you're going to like us. And he said, well, you know, there's no reason for you to jump and run and scream like you all do. He said, it's just a demonstrative thing that you could contain it. And I said, well, if Jesus ever gets in you, you won't be able to contain it. I said, let me tell you. I said, have you ever been to a ball game? He said, yeah. I said, have you seen people, they paint their face up and they wear their team logos on their clothes and they scream and spill popcorn all over their neighbors and other things and they get excited. And I said, maybe in next section, there's a little old couple sitting over there just, yay. I said, everybody's different. I said, when you get saved, you may run around the church or you may sit here and just be filled with the Spirit. I said, all kinds of different things happen to people. He said, well, I'm not emotional. He was white-knuckling it, too, when he was saying that. And I said, well, let me ask you this. I said, if I stuck you with a hat pin, would you get emotional? That's kind of weird, but that's what I thought of at the moment. He goes, well, I guess so. I said, would you move? He said, yeah. I said, well, if you won the lottery, would you do some cartwheels across the front? He said, yeah, I think so. I said, then don't tell me you're not emotional. I said, when Jesus gets a hold of you, things change. You begin to just not worry about what anybody thinks about you. I am so past the point where I care what you think about me. The only person I want to please is Jesus. He's the one that I want to say, well done. Hallelujah. I want to worship him with everything I've got. I want him to know how much I love him. I want to be crazy for God. I want to be so on fire for God that people know when I walk in the room, there's something different about that lady. Hallelujah. I believe that you need to affect your sphere of influence. I fly a lot, so I'm in the airport quite a bit. In fact, about 3 times a week. And I know everyone there that works for Delta on a first name basis. I know the baggage handlers. I know the gate agents. I know the red coat managers. I know the people in the first class lounge because I fly so much they gave me a free thing to go in there. And I know a lot of the flight attendants that are based in Nashville. And you know what? That is my sphere of influence. And I decided one day, I'm going to touch these people. I'm going to make a difference in their lives. And so about a month ago, I walked in the Sky Club in Nashville. And this little lady that works behind the counter to slide my card, you know, to get me in the building, in the room, she said, oh, thank God, Karen's here. I said, what is it? She said, I am so sick. I've thrown up 3 times this morning. And there was a room full of businessmen on their phones, on their little iPads, in their little suits with their little leather attaches. And they were just staring at us. And she said, I knew that if you walked in, that you would pray for me and God would heal me. She left me no choice. On the authority of the word of God and the power of the name Jesus, be healed. Sickness, go back to the pit you came from. Man, I had a crowd gathered. That was the most interesting thing they had seen in months. But guess what happened? Linda screamed, "Oh, I'm healed. The pain is gone." Hallelujah. I've got two red coats. The red coats, not those kind of red coats. Red coat managers at Delta. And they came to church with me. We had Brother Lee Stone King come for Pentecost Sunday this past May. I invited a lot of people. Two came. And I was up singing in the choir, and I looked back and saw him walk in. I about had a Holy Ghost fit in the choir. And as soon as church was over and I could get to them, I got back there, and I began to pray with them. And I'm proud to report that both of them received the gift of the Holy Ghost. I believe that God puts us on this earth to be salt and light. Salt makes people thirsty. Are you making anybody thirsty? And light illuminates the way. Are you salt and light in your sphere of influence? Those that are around you. Does anybody know that you're a Christian? Does anybody know that you've been baptized in the name of Jesus? Has anybody heard you tell a story about God healing you or delivering you or setting you free or making a way where there seemed to be no way? Or just when you screamed, "Jesus," the wreck was avoided on the highway. Tell the goodness of the Lord. Tell the testimonies. The Bible says make known his deeds among the people. And that's what I like to do. I like to tell stories of the goodness of God. Things that he's done for me. Things that he has kept me from. And things that he has brought me through. He's never failed me. If he fails you, you'll be the first person he's ever failed. Because God does not fail. Hallelujah. Sister Tucker asked me to sing this next song. I was going to sing it anyway, but I'm going to dedicate it to her. She said she sang it here once before, and we're somehow kind of related. Where are you? Her grandmother is my stepmother's sister. Is that right? So we're kind of related. My dad remarried after my mom was killed by a drunk driver. And about 2 years later, my dad remarried and married her grandmother's sister. So we kind of know each other and know about each other and know some of the same people. This song talks about the name of Jesus. Anybody thankful for the name of Jesus? There's power in that name. You speak the name of Jesus and the very atmosphere in the room changes. The Bible says everything we do in word or deed, that we're to do it all in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Everything I do with somebody and tell them I'm a classic. Oh, yes. Jesus. Hallelujah. No other name. No other name but Jesus. I'm so thankful. Hallelujah. Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Thank you.
Hallelujah. I don't know why Jesus loved me. I don't know why he cared. I don't know why he sacrificed his life. Oh, but I'm glad, so glad he did. I don't know why Jesus loved me. feel discouraged. Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely? For heaven and home. When Jesus is my portion, I said Jesus is my portion. Jesus is my portion. A kind hallelujah.
There's nothing more I love than praising my God. I love singing songs to Him. I love worshiping Him in spirit and in truth. I love telling Him how much I love Him and how much I appreciate what He's done for me. He is so good to me. He never fails. He keeps me. He protects me. He heals me. He delivers me. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. I've never had God turn me away when I called on his name. And I've been in some desperate situations and I've called on his name and he's always there. Hallelujah. Somebody, I'm reaching to you tonight. I just want to let you know tonight that whatever it is that you're facing, whatever it is that you're going through, you need to start trusting God. You need to start leaning on Him. You need to stop trying to figure out how He's going to do it and just start praising Him for doing it. Just start trusting Him for doing it. His ways are so much higher than our ways. His thoughts are so much higher than our thoughts. His way for me is so much better than anything I could come up with for myself. I trust Him. I trust Him. I trust Him. You say, how can you trust Him? Oh, it is a walk of faith. It's scary sometimes when you don't have the answer. And everybody else is getting their answer. And you're wondering, when's my answer coming? Why is everybody else getting the victory and I'm still over here facing my situation? Let me tell you, if you just keep walking, if you just keep trusting, if you just keep believing, if you just keep doing what's right, God is working on your behalf behind the scenes. And when the situation comes to fruition, it'll be better than you could ever imagine. God is working on it for you. One of my favorite childhood books is The Little Engine That Could. So many people are negative. We've got to watch what we're saying, folks. So many people are negative. Well, that'll never happen for me. Well, guess what? It probably won't. I mean, the Bible says it talks about a lot. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. You know, and then Henry Ford said, whether you think you can or you think you can't, you're right. You're right. It's right here. The battle is right here in the mind. I tend to believe that God can do anything. I trust Him. And the more I trust Him, the more He does for me, the better it gets, the more He shows up and tells me that He's got it under control. We got to quit being negative and saying it can never happen for me. And we've got to start trusting and saying, I think I can. I think I can. I think I can. If you don't have that book, you know, need to get on Amazon and order it. Or go to the bookstore and get it and read it to yourself and then give it to your kids. Hallelujah. That's the thought for tonight. I think I can. I think I can. I think I can. Why? Because the Bible says I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Now, if you don't believe that, then you must not believe the Bible. Because God has given us so many amazing promises. He's given us so many things to encourage us in His Word. And there's, you know, Apostle Paul went through some things. He was beaten twice, 39 stripes. He was, his countrymen in peril. He was shipwrecked twice and floated in the sea for a couple days. He was in prison, and they let him down over the wall in a basket. There was all kinds of things that happened to him. And he was beaten with a rod, it says in the Word, a rod. Now, I hope none of you have ever been beaten with a rod. I know I haven't been. Just the rod of correction. Just, you know. But not a rod as in the sense of a real rod. If we had to do some of the things that Apostle Paul did, I'm afraid some of us wouldn't make it. When did we get to be such wimpy Christians? I don't think this church is, but I'm telling you, I've been some places where people just say, well, that'll never happen for me. I could never do that. The Lord will never work that out. And then I come back in 10 years to sing for them, and they're still in the same shape they were in then. If they want something to change, they need to start trusting in God and believing that He's going to take care of the situation. How am I doing on my time, girl? She's supposed to be helping me with my time down here. I don't have a clock and my iPad's off, so I don't know. And there's no clock back there. Does that mean y'all want me to keep going? I want to tell y'all a story that happened to me. I believe in sharing testimonies of things God's done. It builds people's faith. I was in a situation where I travel and sing. I travel and minister in churches, just like what I'm doing tonight. And every service is different. No service has the same. I don't just go down the list and do the same thing every service. Every church is different. And you kind of just have to feel and find the flow. But I live on love offerings. How many of you could do that for 10 years like I've done these last 10 years? I just live on love offering. You never know what you're going to get week to week. You just pray that they love you. And if they don't, then God's my provider and He always takes care of me. But I had been in a situation where, Pastor, for 12 weeks people canceled on me in a row. They would call on Wednesday and say, sis, we can't have you. Something's come up. We can't have you this Sunday. Well, the first couple weeks I was okay with it. But after 12 weeks, with no income, no leaven, it was pretty rough. And I know that those pastors aren't my provider. God's my provider. And I was praising Him through it all. But praising Him wasn't paying my bills. See, I still had the rent due. I still had the car note due. I still wanted to eat. I could have got away with about 6 months of not eating and been all right. I would have looked good when I was finished with that diet. But, you know, I there was other things I needed to pay, and I didn't have the money, and I was getting frustrated. And about the eighth week, I was really getting kind of ticked. And I said, Jesus, I've already repented of everything from birth to now. So if there's anything that I haven't repented of, reveal it to me. And I repent now. Nothing happened. No bolt of lightning. Nothing changed. Jesus, I guess you don't want me to do this anymore. I guess you just don't want me to sing and travel anymore. And so I'll be happy to do something else. Maybe I'll go get a job at Starbucks. At least I could have some good coffee and some stale pastries at the end of the night, God. Whatever it is, Lord, that you want me to do. And the Lord said, open your Bible. Well, I opened my Bible, and in my Bible it said, sing, O daughter, for I dwell in your midst and have come to give you peace. And I was like, peace, that's awesome, but it's not going to pay the bills. I need a little more than peace, although I appreciate that. Another week, another call. Another week, another call. 12 weeks. The 11th week, I was really getting irritated. They were knocking on my door. I said, God, this is not a good testimony for you. It's embarrassing for me, and it's embarrassing for you. I trust you. I'm not an idiot, God. I can get a job. Do you want me to do something else? And the Lord said, open the Bible. What a concept. Read God's word. And I had just that very day been listening to some preaching CDs, trying to encourage myself in the Lord. And I heard a preacher saying, God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. You know, they do that ha ha for emphasis. And I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. And I said, I just put my last heel in the freezer from my last loaf. I felt like that woman that Elijah was going to come and say, make me a cake. I had no groceries. And I just kept trusting God. I would go to my church every week and just praise God. I was wondering why they didn't ask me, why are you here every week? Because I'm out. I'm at home one Sunday a month to stay connected and under my covering. But I was there for 12 weeks and nobody said, they just acted like it was normal. And when the Lord told me to open my Bible that second time, it opened to Haggai chapter 2. And it said, the gold is mine and the silver is mine, saith the Lord of hosts, and your latter will be greater than your former. Now, I received that, and I just said, Lord, you know what? The battle's right here. I am sick and tired of this. I know that you know where the money is for me, that you're going to take care of me. And would you believe that very afternoon, I got a phone call? It was from a pastor that I'd never been to his church. He said, I called a friend of mine that I knew would have your phone number, and I asked for your number, and the Lord spoke to me this morning and told me you need rent money. How much rent do you need? And I told him, he said, well, we're going to send that to you. The Lord told me to do that. I said, well, can you overnight it? And he did. And I paid my rent and I got current on that. And I went to church Sunday and somebody shook my hand and in their hand was a wad of bills and it caught me up on my car note and it got me current and there was enough left over to put gas in my car. Hallelujah. And I began to realize God has not forsaken me. God knows right where we are. He knows exactly what we need. If you're in the middle of a financial situation, you just need to trust that God knows and he's going to take care of you. And then not too long after that, I finally got another booking. Hallelujah. They said they didn't call on Wednesday. They actually kept me. And I went, and it was a ladies' conference in California. And I was singing, and while I was singing, the very back tooth in my head fell out. And I caught it and put it in my pocket and kept singing, hallelujah. And it already had a porcelain crown on it that I had paid $1,200 for. It's on eBay if anybody's interested. I guess she's not. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so I said, Jesus, I don't know what you're trying to do or teach me, but I got home and I went to my dentist and he said, it fell out way above the root. We're going to have to cut that out in 4 pieces and it's going to be oral surgery and it's going to be $2,600. And I'm thinking, man, I should have been a dentist. And I said, well, I'm flying out this week. I can't do it this week. And he said, well, you can't fly, that's for sure, because the pressure from the bleeding, you need at least 2 weeks off. And I said, well, I can't do it right now. But I said, we'll get it scheduled when I get back from this trip. And as I was walking to my car, I said, Jesus, you are provider. See, I trust him now for everything. If he could do that other thing for me, guess what? He can do anything. He's provider. I said, Jesus, now, I know you made me, and you could put a new tooth in there. If you choose to do that, just boom, and there's a new tooth. Or you can provide the $2,600 so I can get the surgery done. Whatever your will is, Jesus. So I go on to my next place. I'm trying to build somebody's faith here. I'm trying to let you know that God is a financial provider. He doesn't leave his children hopeless. I go to this church, and actually it was a state women's conference, and I spoke Thursday night, and Friday day, and Friday night, and Saturday, and it got over at 1 o'clock, and they didn't think I'd done enough, so they rented a flatbed truck and had me do a concert in the parking lot Saturday night. And then I was singing and speaking Sunday morning, and I thought I was just going to sing 3 or 4 songs Sunday night. And the pastor called and said, I feel like you need to speak and sing tonight again. And I was tarred, as y'all say down here. And when I got to Sunday night and the very last song I was doing, I was so tired. But the Lord told me the song to sing, and he said, I want you to sing For Every Mountain. Now, that song is a power ballad. It modulates 8 times, and I mean, it kills. And you sing, and then you drop. It's usually the last song, so you can just fall in the altar. Hallelujah. And so, I mean, I sang it, and I don't just give this much. When I sing, I give it all I've got because I feel like Jesus is worthy of my best. And so I sang it, and I was ready to drop. And when I finished singing, for this I give you praise. And I was, thank you. I was going to go drop. They had chairs up here on the choir loft, and I was going to get on the second row and hide and lay down on the floor and go just for a minute, and then I was going to come back out and pray with people. And all of a sudden, I hear in the microphone, Sister Karen, I think you need to sing that song again. Oh, I said, Jesus, give me strength, Lord. Because I believe in obedience. And when the pastor wants you to sing it again, you sing it again. So I just got back in it, and I mustered up every ounce of strength I had, and I sang it again. And I don't know if it sounded quite as good as the first time, but I tried. And I just gave it everything, every bit of gusto I had. And all of a sudden, while I was singing, you're not going to believe this, people started running to the altar and throwing money on the altar. I've never had that happen while I was singing. And this is what's even more amazing. As they would throw down their offering, they would fall out under the power of God. And they would just shake and tremble. And when I finished that song the second time, there was 21 people on their backs shaking, and there was money everywhere. I went that time and literally fell between the chairs and began to pray. And I stayed back there a little longer than I was planning to. But I was praying and thanking God for helping me to get through it. And all of a sudden I heard my name, and I was like, oh, Jesus, please, I cannot sing it again. I was like, I'll be pulling me up some Kurt Carr and letting them sing it. Hallelujah. And all of a sudden I heard, Sister Karen, come up here. And I walked up, and the pastor was standing here. He said, Sister Harding, the Lord told me while you were singing that song the first time that you have a need. And he told me that if you would sing it again out of obedience, that he would meet your need. And we've counted up this money, and it's $2,600. Does that mean anything to you? Woo! I begin to just thank God. Oh, you're so good, God. You know exactly what we need and when we need it, Lord. You are a provider. You've never failed. Lord, all we have to do is ask in your name, and you'll do it, God. We trust you, Jesus. We believe you, God. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, he's never failed me. There's so many stories. I could stand here all night. I'm not going to do that. How's my time, sis? I'm doing good. I could stand here and tell you all night about things that God has done for me. He's provided. I needed $1,100 one month to be current on my bills. It's a walk of faith what I do. I just walk by faith, not by sight. But I know that God's going to take care of me. You know why I know that? Because I pay my tithes. And when you give your tithes and offerings, the Bible says he's obligated to take care of you. Do y'all read the same Bible I read? Yes, it says in Malachi that he will rebuke the devourer. He will take care of us. And it also says in Luke 6:38, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give unto your bosom. People are going to bless you. God uses people to bless you. If you give, somebody say hallelujah. Oh, it always gets quiet when I talk about the giving part. If we would only realize that's where the blessing is, in the giving. The more we give, the more God stands there and says, they're obeying my word. Let's pour a little more blessing on them. I needed $1,100 to be current on that month. I didn't get worried. I knew that he had done it before. So I knew he was going to take care of me. I'm talking about this for a long time. Somebody must have some needs tonight. I'm trying to encourage you in the Lord. Just let me tell you, I was at my CD table after a service, which, by the way, I have some back there, and you need at least one of my CDs to go to heaven. I'm glad you guys laughed. You got it. Hallelujah. I was at one church, and they just went like they thought I was serious. Hallelujah. But I was at the CD table, and this man comes walking over to me in an old grungy-looking jacket with food dried on the lapels, and I knew he was coming straight for me. And I told my sister, I said, you sell the CDs a minute. I'm going to be talking to this person. And so he comes over to me, and he says, nothing but this. He puts something in his hand from inside this jacket. He says, you need this. And I dropped it in my purse and turned around to thank him, and he was gone. I asked my sister, did she see him? She saw him. I asked people in the lobby, did you see the man in the green jacket? Nobody saw him but me and my sister. I sent men in the restroom. I sent people in the parking lot. Nobody saw him. Got in the car. Reached in my bag, because you never know what people are going to give you at a CD table, right? I looked in my bag. And there was a wad of money about that big with a rubber band around it. I counted it out, and it was 11 $100 bills. I believe an angel of God brought me the money I needed. If he could send ravens to feed Elijah, if he could part the Red Sea, how easy is it for him to provide for his children? He delights in providing for his children. Hallelujah. I want to challenge you, church. I don't know what your financial situation is. I'm not getting in your territory, Pastor. I'm just challenging you, church, to be a giving church. You know, if you just lay a sacrificial offering on the altar, $5. God, this is my seed offering tonight. I just want you to take care of my finances. He always comes through. He always comes through. And you say, oh, I don't get it. I don't understand it. You know, there's a man that pastors in Ohio, and Brother Harold Linder's brother, I don't know if you know, brother. I mean, it's Harold Linder. Do you know him? His sister goes to church there, and her husband, and they were having a missionary that night, and it was a prayer service on a midweek. They didn't even have a service. The missionaries needed somewhere to go, and they said, come to our church. We'll bless you with a love offering, and you can just have the night off and pray with us. Well, the Lord spoke to him in the middle of prayer meeting and said, you need to give these missionaries $30,000. He has a small church. He said, yes, Lord, I'll give the first $1,000. See, if we would just learn to trust God. When he speaks something to us, we need to obey and do it, and then he takes care of us. Bigger than we could dream of. Well, then all these other people started giving, and they got $29,000 on the altar, and they still needed $1,000 more. And the only people that hadn't given was the pastor's sister and her husband. And they had just finished saving up $1,000 to get a new car, and it was in their bank account. And their car was a rattle trap falling apart. And they had worked hard and saved that money. And they were going to go look for a new car. And the Lord spoke to the husband and said, give that $1,000 to these missionaries. And the wife wasn't buying it quite so readily. Finally, the Lord spoke to her and got through to her, and she said, okay, honey, give it. They gave it. The missionaries got their $30,000. It was a miracle. They left there rejoicing, cut their deputation short. They got back to their field of labor. On the way home from the prayer meeting, the sister and brother-in-law's car broke down. Wouldn't you know it? That's like the old devil, isn't it? You give your $1,000, and then the car breaks down. I told you, honey, we need a new car. He said, listen, honey, God spoke to me directly, and he's going to take care of it. The next day, the phone rings at the house. The husband got a ride to work. The wife's there alone. Whatever her name is, let's call her Jill Smith. Hope there's not a Jill Smith here. Hallelujah. And he said, she answered the phone, and he said, is this Jill Smith? And she said, yes. And he said, well, I cannot get you off my mind. He said, it was like a neon sign flashing on my wall this morning in prayer. He said, I own the Toyota dealership here in town, and the Lord spoke to me to give you a car. Do you need a car? Her husband got a ride home from work, and when he got home from work, there was a brand new Toyota sitting in his driveway. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, God wants to bless his people. Hallelujah. I'm so sick and tired of us, the Jesus name people, being so, we don't have it. We can't do it. We don't have enough. We'll never get there. You know, yes, we will get there. It's not us. It's him. It's Jesus in us. Do we really trust him, or we just say we trust him? Hallelujah. Man, it's a blessed life given for the Lord. I'm going to sing maybe one or two more songs, and I know what time it is. My little timer's telling me time's up, and I know that most of you have to work tomorrow. I hope I'm not keeping you too late. But I do feel like I need to sing for every mountain tonight. And I know that somebody needs to hear from God. If you need something from God, don't wait till I'm finished. Go ahead and come down while I'm singing. I'm telling you, God wants to do something miraculous in this place tonight. If you need a financial miracle, come forward. If you need a healing in your body, you can come forward. The Lord always asks people to do something before he healed them. Stretch forth your hand. Dip 7 times, Naaman. Go wash in the pool. Pick up your bed and walk. He always asks you to do something so your faith would be to rise and come forward and receive what God has for you tonight. He has never failed. He's an awesome God. Receive it tonight. Hallelujah.
Starting
ready to pray with. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for your miracles that you're taking place right now, that you're doing for us right now. Thank you, Lord, for the healings that are taking place right now. Thank you, God, that finances are going to be blessed. Thank you, Lord, that lost loved ones are coming home, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for restoring backsliders, Jesus. Thank you, God, for what you're doing right now in this place. If you need a miracle, the miracle worker's here. Just lift a hand and thank him for your miracle right now. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go ahead and praise him. Go ahead and praise him. Lord, you are mighty. You're worthy. You've never failed. You are everything I need. God, provide financially every need in this church. Every saint of God that has a need, Lord, let abundance flow, God, to them. Lord, I pray that the miraculous would take place. Let miracles of healing take place right now, God, while we're standing here in your presence. Lord, you have sent angels to minister to the heirs of salvation. Right now, God, fill somebody with the Holy Ghost. Encourage somebody, Lord. Turn them around, God. Let them walk out different than they came in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Until you get to youth conference at Opry Mills, you can pray now. Hallelujah. Let the Lord touch you right now, young people. Hallelujah. There it is. Yes. Hallelujah. God's got your miracle tonight. Forever.